So welcome, everyone. My name is John Stuart, and I am the Associate Dean for Cultural and Community Engagement at FIU's College of Communication, Architecture, and the Arts. And it's Monday night, and we're back again in September with Deborah Briggs and the Betsy, my partner in crime here. And we're so proud to be offering a new series, Overture to Overtown. And we'll be with you for the next 4 weeks with performances, by musicians and poets, as well as commentary by preeminent scholars who will celebrate and talk about Overtown in the past, present, and the future. So we invite you to join us all month, and feel free during any time during the event. The event tonight will have, it has a lot of different components, and it's a hugely exciting program. And if you have a question at any time during the program, just put your question in the chat, and put your email address just to me as the host. And if you do that after the show, I will send the questions out to Dr. Fields or Carole Taylor or whoever you think should address the question, and we'd be happy to try to answer it for you. So with that, I am going to hand the evening over to Deborah Briggs and welcome you all. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm delighted to be here, and I hope you are too. I wanted to tell you a little bit about the program that we're going to embark on tonight. For the last 8 years, the Betsy Hotel has been honoring Overtown's history and its legacy through a project we call Overture to Overtown. Traditionally, it's a time at the hotel when we step up our seven-night-a-week jazz program to bring in even more talent and performances so we can link jazz to other art forms and really celebrate the genre. However, of course, in 2020, due to COVID, the festival is virtual, and it's right here with you, our global audience. And it'll be better than ever because of the committed partnership of so many members of the extended South Florida civic community. So our presenting sponsors include Florida International University's Miami Beach Urban Studios, and those folks are here tonight helping us. That's Dean John Stewart, Colette Mello, who assists with special events. And we have another assistant, Raymond Reyna, who's assisting. So they're making all the difference for us. And their funding partner, the City of Miami Beach, FIU-MBUS, is a pillar organization in Miami Beach. And we are so privileged to be partnering with them. WDNA Sirius Jazz Radio is another important partner. It is the only radio station dedicated in South Florida to Sirius Jazz. And then, of course, the Greater Miami Convention and Visitor Bureau, South Florida Cares Mentoring, that does a lot of work in Overtown, the Miami Jazz Cooperative, and then one of our special partner organizations, Diaspora Vibe Cultural Arts Incubator. And of course, many others. If I went through them all, we would be here all evening and not get to the subject matter. So I just wanted to say all of these partners are here for the solidarity and the charity of working together toward this common goal of celebrating Overtown. I want to also formally and publicly thank our amazing videographer and sound man, Mike Harvey. You're going to be seeing the fruits of his labor tonight. Many of us in town know him as a jazz drummer, an amazing jazz drummer, yet he is also a very accomplished behind the camera and studio guy. And so in two recording sessions, he has brought musicians and poets to life. He came to an empty Betsy Hotel in the lobby and filled it up with jazz and poetry again. And we thank him from the bottom of our hearts. And now, last but not least, I wanted to mention Carole Taylor, who's going to be our next speaker here. Carole has been, she is an artist, musician, activist, and entrepreneur. A lot of people know her as the force behind Miami to Go, which is a very important business in Miami. But she also stepped up this year to give our Overture to Overtown Festival a conscience that reflects what our community wants to say and is feeling. We have really worked seamlessly together to bring together the best and brightest musicians, poets, and scholars to engage and present with each other and for you. Carole Ann will introduce our first performers, and then we'll move on to the scholarship of the evening and back to music and poetry. So thank you for coming, and I'll pass the torch to Carole Ann.
Carole Ann, you're muted. You just have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Deborah, and thank you, John. I'm really thrilled to welcome our first two performers to this year's Overtown Festival. Musician, vocalist, Brenda Alford, and spoken word poet, Butterfly. Brenda's a world-respected jazz singer who has performed and recorded with the greats. I encourage you to read her bio and the bios of all of our contributors on our landing page at thebetsyhotel.com, because like her, they all have an amazing story of accomplishment. Brenda will open our program singing Soul Shadow by Bill Withers. And right after that, we'll feature Butterfly, also known as Rebecca Vaughn, born and raised in Miami, and whose father had a barbershop in Overtown. Her unique storytelling skills will take you away to another place and time. So with me, welcome Brenda Alford with Alan Paul on the keys, and then Butterfly with pianist Jim Gazier and bassist James Owsley. Though these performances are on tape, and we tape them at the Betsy, they were both captured in one take. So enjoy the program, and let's listen to Brenda Alford.
Thank you, Carole. And so everyone.
Francisco morning coming clear and cold. Don't know if I'm waking or I'm dreaming. Riding with Fats Waller on the Super Chief. He said music's real rest is seeming. Oh, he played a feeling that won't go away. Left the sound of his soul in the air. I can hear it out there, and I know he left a soul shadow on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. He left a soul shadow on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. In memory of all of those great ones, some of them came right through our town here in Miami. Standing by the window as the fog rolls in, I swear I can hear that far off music. Jelly Roll is playing down in Storyville, and Satchmo Wedding somewhere in Chicago. You ought to hear them play, a feeling that won't go away. Lift the sound of their souls in the air. I can hear it out there, and I know he left a soul shadow on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. They left a soul shadow. On my mind, on my mind. A Billy Holiday on my mind, on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. Carmen McRae on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. A shovel boot and do the do ya da 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 da. On my mind, on my mind. Ray Charles got a woman over town. Oh, oh, on my mind, on my mind, on my mind. They left a soul shadow on my mind, on my mind, oh, on my mind. They left a soul shadow. My mind, oh, 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 oh.
I just wanted to say that the next thing we're featuring is Butterfly. And Butterfly shared with us, this is the first time she has performed in 2020. And she came, she wanted to participate in this program. And then afterwards she said, I still have it, I can still do it. And we hope you love it like we did.
What you know about jazz? I'm talking good jazz. Well, you can't have good jazz backing you up with your lyrical vibe unless you have good musicians in the mix. Oh yeah. I got Jim on them 88 keys, and I got Jamie on the bass. And right about now, I need you to roll with my poetic vibe as we rewind back in time over town. See, we all have roots. And my roots, well, I came from the womb of a woman named Ruth Rosalind Gibson. That's right. Raised right in the heart of Overtown. Address was 1159 Northwest First Court. She got her education through the walls and corridors of Miss Anderson Kindergarten, 13th Street in Northwest First Avenue. Oh, and then she trickled and moved on to Douglas Primary School. Then she went through the walls of Phyllis Wheatley Elementary. And she would finish the last of her education along the walls of those tornadoes, those beautiful colors of orange and black. Booker T. Washington, junior and senior high school. We can't forget who helped to be the one that I was created in love with, and I'm talking about my daddy. His name was Nathaniel Renslow Vons, known as Nat the Barber. You gotta start somewhere, so Chink's Barbershop was the first black-owned barbershop on 2nd Avenue in Overtown. Daddy got his skills and his lessons on how to make somebody look good when they get up out that chair and walk out into this thing called life, this big old world. But then he moved out on his own, and he opened up what they call the Downtown Barbershop. Address was 707 Northwest 2nd Avenue. I told you earlier what you know about jazz. What you know about jazz. What you know about jazz.
Louis Armstrong, aka Satchmo.
Well, he loved him some biscuits from the Georgia Cafe, which was right next door to the Downtown Barbershop. And in my daddy's chair, he would make sure that he had Nat King Cole looking good. Duke Ellington came through the barbershop a couple of times. Oh, and he was born Cassius Clay, but in time you would come to know him as Muhammad Ali, float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. He would only allow my daddy's fingertips and clippers to cut his hair whenever he was in town. Overtown. I said it earlier. We all have roots. And my roots are buried deep in the walls of Overtown, all because of who I came from. My mama, Ruth Rosalind Gibson, and my daddy, Nathaniel Renslow Vons, a.k.a. Nat the Barber, also known as the Barber to the Stars. What you know about jazz? What you know about history, history, history.
Amazing, amazing.
Yeah. really incredible. Well, that kind of transitions us, I think, to a brief presentation that Deborah is going to kind of walk us through about the history of Overtown. And that's before we get to our featured star, Dr. Dorothy Fields. But Deborah, I'm going to tee up our PowerPoint presentation for you. And if you hang on to your hat, I'll get myself there right now.
Right. So let me just explain to everyone what my job is for the next 5 minutes. It's really to share the arc of Overtown history. And so this short presentation starts with the banner you see when you enter Overtown, you know, welcome to Overtown, founded in the 1800s. And we quickly take you through Overtown as a place where families were raised and music and art were celebrated. And what it leads us to is a period when everything was interrupted and Dr. Dorothy Jenkins found her calling. So John is actually controlling these slides, so you'll see me with my finger.
We're in trouble.
So welcome to Historic Overtown, and let's move right ahead. So the first few slides, this is explaining to you where Overtown is, in case you want to read up on this later. But everything in Overtown was interrupted when I-95 was built. In the late 1950s, that was a sort of a federal mandate to build interstates. And as you can see on the left, this is a vibrant place. Every space is taken with homes and buildings and a busy goings on. In the middle, you see the obliteration of half of that city. And on the right, you see the bridge that was built. Next. So these next few slides show you what was obliterated. And this is what was obliterated. People, businesses, a way of life. And then these next few slides show you the kinds of people who frequented Overtown. Thurgood Marshall, Malcolm X, Muhammad Ali. And then the next few slides show you the various hotels in the area, because musicians of color who performed in Miami and the beaches couldn't stay there. And so they went over town to another area and stayed in places owned by Black proprietors. The Mary Elizabeth Hotel was one of them. And this is, if you go back, John, it's a beautiful slide because it shows you in exquisite detail the kind of interiors in these hotels. This was a beautiful place. The next few slides show you the kinds of nightlife that were happening in Overtown and the famous people. This one I want to stop at for a second, because next week we're going to read some poetry by Langston Hughes. But this is sort of cool because on the right you see actually a playbill from a poetry reading Langston Hughes did at the Mount Zion Church in Overtown. So, and tonight, of course, we have our own poets reading in sort of homage to that. You have Sam Cooke, whose music's being sung tonight at the Harlem Square Club. These are some of the playbills. Dizzy Jones at the Mary Elizabeth. Sam and Dave, that's Sam Cooke and Dave at the Nightbeat, which was a club at the Sir John Hotel, which is a hotel frequented by many famous people. Nat King Cole at the Lord Calvert. Again, the Sir John Hotel, if you look carefully at these, you can see it was quite a hopping scene over there, and with Bathing Beauties and everything. Etta James at the Nightbeat. And then, of course, Louis Satchmo Armstrong, a crossover star. I first met Louis Armstrong by watching Merv Griffin. So he definitely was a crossover star at the Club Zanzibar. Here he is with a marquee, a playbill for that. This slide's important just to show you the critical mass of culture and business that was going on in the Second Avenue Historical Cultural Corridor, which was Little Broadway. And it was there and then it wasn't there anymore. And here you go, and this is why. We'll be talking more about this as the weeks progress, what happened, what we learned from it, and where Overtown is going. The next slide, we see Purvis Young, because it's sort of interesting to know how the news of what happens in neighborhoods comes to the greater world, and it's often through the eyes and ears of artists. So Purvis Young was born and raised in Overtown, and one of his famous works is called The Struggle, and it's actually in the permanent collection of the Smithsonian, and the struggle he's talking about is the struggle in Overtown. We thought it was interesting to just reflect for a second. Again, what is that struggle? Well, the Lyric Theater, built in 1913, was anchored the strip everyone performed there. Events where world known citizens came to celebrate and perform there. And by the 50s and 60s, that was a derelict venue. Next. In the year 2000, with Dorothy Jenkins' intervention and activism, people like Whitney Houston were taking notice of the lyric. And a preliminary restoration had been done in the year 2000. And in 2002, she did film a music video there. So now we jump forward to 2014, when the Lyric Theater was completely reborn, and this activism that Dorothy Fields generated and that rippled out from her created this transformation of this building. And what she said was, it was her vision that the world would know what had happened here and would continue to celebrate culture in that building. So we end where we begin tonight with our first of five scholars who will talk about Overtown. This is a slide about Dorothy Jenkins. On the left, she's a little girl in Overtown. In the middle, she is the incredible activist in front of her finest work, which is the restoration of the Lyric Theater. And what she's going to talk about is how she came to this calling and what it has meant to her and what she thinks it means to the world. So I'd like to introduce Dorothy Jenkins to you and have her tell her own story. Thank you.
Thank you and good evening. Growing up in Miami's colored town, now known as Overtown, was exciting for me. Long before my birth, my maternal grandparents immigrated from Harbor Island, Bahamas, and settled in colored town in 1903, just 7 years after the white industrialist Henry M. Flagler extended the railroad from Palm Beach to Miami and built the Royal Palm Hotel in downtown. Black laborers were assigned lodging on the west side of what would become downtown Miami so they could live close to their jobs. Black laborers were the primary workforce during the first half of the 20th century in Miami. Many were injured and some lost their lives planting dynamite so the rails could be laid and roads and hotels and residents built. But the Black laborers did more than that. They were the ones who made it possible for Miami to become a city on July 28, 1896. At that time, a third of the men who stood for the city of Miami's incorporation were Black. According to pioneer merchant Isidore Coyne, it was a Black man who made the most inspiring speech for incorporation. That man, A.C. Lightburn, was a member of the Congregation of Greater Bethel AME Church located in Miami's colored town. After the 1896 election, Blacks were disfranchised and were not allowed to vote for nearly 40 years. At the turn of the 20th century, like many others in colored town, my grandmother was a washerwoman and my grandfather a handyman. Two of their seven children were born in Key West, and the other five were born at their homestead at 159 Northwest 10th Street, two blocks north of where the Lyric Theater now stands. All seven children finished college and returned to Miami as professionals before the end of World War II. Four were teachers, two medical doctors, and one lawyer who later became the second Black judge in Miami and the fourth in the state of Florida.
Dr. Fields, you just muted yourself somehow.
There you go.
All right. Later, he became the second Black judge in Miami and the fourth in the state of Florida. He never let us forget it. At a very young age, I began listening to their stories. At first, I hated it. And it wasn't until I was an adult that I realized I should have been recording them then. As they recalled individual and collective childhood experiences, happenings in colored town, and they watched as the city of Miami grew up. It was their stories and the stories I heard at church that I always wanted to record and share with others. These are stories of initiatives, resistance, and resilience. In spite of Jim Crow laws that segregated white people from Black people in every phase of life, the Black community found a way to provide needed goods and services. Similar to Black people in Atlanta, Memphis, Tulsa, and other places, Blacks in Miami built their own self-contained community. In 1974, the opportunity for me to act on my dream of recording their stories became real. I was a Miami-Dade County school librarian and reading teacher at Myrtle Grove Elementary School in Opa-locka. The school then was all white. Preparing for the then upcoming 1976 bicentennial, the 200th celebration of the founding of the USA, I wanted books about the Black community for all of the children in Dade County to read. There were none in my library, but I assumed that some had been written. I called the downtown county library and asked them to pull 15 or 20 books about Blacks in Miami and Florida. And after checking, the library clerk came back and said, "Well, we only have a folder with obituaries about Black people." Then she continued, "I guess those people haven't thought enough of themselves to write their history," unquote. Stunned, I continued asking questions. It was suggested that I call the Historical Museum of Southern Florida, now History Miami. They didn't have any books about Black people either. But the person who answered the call, educator, historian, Dr. Thelma Peters, and her colleague, historian Arva Moore Parks, welcomed me and became my mentors in the process and lifelong friends. The rest is history. I was and remain determined to collect and interpret colored people's history from the people themselves first, so other generations and cultures can know the feelings and frustrations of the time. Rather than write one book, I wanted then and now to collect, process, and make available primary sources such as letters and documents, photographs and yearbooks, obituaries, school, church programs, information from civics, social and fraternal organizations, and of course, oral histories. Because from these primary sources, many books, documentaries, and platforms yet unnamed can be produced. In 1977, I enrolled at the Georgia State Archives Institute at Emory University and earned certification in archives administration. The paper I wrote for the graduate course was The Development of Black Miami's Photographic Archives, a community repository focusing on the collections of everyday people in Colortown. When I returned to Miami, I established and operated the Black Archives, History and Research Foundation of South Florida, Inc. as a volunteer. I did it on nights and weekends and holidays, even with a family, including two young promising daughters. I continued to work for Dade County Public Schools for 40 years. Along the way, I met Clyde Killens, Overtown's longtime entertainment promoter, who brought in many of the celebrities. And of course, Purvis Young, our hometown artist from Good Red Alley, whose work hangs in museums worldwide. Black residents often visited New York City and compared the bright lights and nightlife there with the bright lights and activities of Overtown Strip, Northwest 2nd Avenue. As a result, some called Overtown Little Broadway. And in the 30s, as the Harlem Renaissance began to slow down, artists from that area often spent winters in Miami's color town. For some, it became the Harlem of the South. And in the 50s, Ruth and Arnold Greenfield's performing arts program, first in Overtown and then in Liberty City, helped a lot of us appreciate music, and some of us learned music. Utilizing the historical process, I developed Black history curriculum for Dade County Public Schools, researched the history of sites designated locally, and six sites were placed on the National Register of Historic Places. I saved buildings from destruction, led the purchase, restoration, and expansion of the footprint of the Lyric Theater, established the historic Overtown Folklife Village, and established Miami-Dade County's Black Heritage Trail, and much more. I'm pleased to say the mission of the Black Archives to record the experience of Miami-Dade County from 1896 to the present is being carried on currently by Timothy Barber, Executive Director, with his staff, including Camilla Pritchett and Jocelyn Hurtado and others. I say to the library clerk, yes, we care. Our actions show that we care. The legacy built for school children, researchers, scholars, and the community at large continues. And for the latest information, I encourage you to go to the Black Archives Historic Lyric Theater website to get the latest information.
Thank you very much. That was great. Carole Ann, you're muted. You will have to unmute yourself here.
Thank you so much, Dorothy. You know, when I came here in 1980, it was Dorothy that introduced me to Overtown. And during my government days, I watched her go before the city of Miami, before Miami-Dade County, and singularly get the funds to rebuild some of the things that you now see in Overtown. So we really appreciate it. We are so indebted. All of Miami is indebted to you for all you've done and continue to do. And in the spirit of keeping memory alive, we'd like to introduce you to our community poet in residence, Jeffrey Phipps. He'll bring you another dimension to this series throughout the month by sharing the poems of historic writers who frequented Overtown. In the last event, which we will have on the Monday of September 28th, he will read his own poetry. Tonight, Jeffrey will recite a poem by W.E.B. Du Bois entitled, My Country, Tis of Thee. Then we'll close the night with another song from Brenda Alford, made famous by the great Sam Cooke. And Jim Gaisier is on the keys. Take it away, Jeffrey.
Okay, let me conjure him up. Here he is.
Hello, my name is Jeffrey Phipps, a community poet in residence for the Overture. Hello, my name is Jeffrey Phipps, a community poet in residence for the Overture to Overtown series. Nearly 100 years ago, a fierce intellectual battle raged across America. On the one hand, there was Marcus Garvey, who was advocating a Back to Africa movement. On the other hand, there was W.E.B. Du Bois, who argued for the integration of African Americans into the American story. By 1929, Du Bois had won the argument, and many in the place that would come to be called Overtown, the Harlem of the South, agreed with him. And they agreed with him partly on the intelligence that he brought to the argument, but also the pathos that he displayed in the poem, My Country, Tis of Thee. Of course you have faced the dilemma. It is unannounced. They all smirk and rise. They are ultra. They remove their hats and look ecstatic. Then they look at you. What shall you do? Noblesse oblige, you cannot be boorish or ungracious. And two, after all, it is your country. And you do love its ideals, if not all of its realities. Now, then, I have thought of a way out. Arise gracefully, remove your hat and tilt your head. Then sing as follows, powerfully, with deep unction. They'll hardly note the little changes and their feelings, and your conscience will thus be saved. My country, 'tis of thee, late land of slavery, of thee I sing. Land where my father's pride slept, where my mother died, from every mountainside let freedom ring. My native country, thee, land of the slave set free, thy fame I love. I love thy rocks and thy rills, and o'er thy hate which chills my heart with purpose thrills to rise above. Let lament swell the breeze and ring from all the trees sweet wisdom song. Let laggard tongues awake, let all those who hear partake, let southern silence quake the sound prolong. Our fathers, God, to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Soon may our land be bright with freedom's happy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King. I hope you enjoyed this poem by W.E.B. Du Bois. And until we meet again, walk good.
This tribute to Overtown, I want to do this song from Sam and Dave. Sam Moore is one of Overtown's own, and this is a timeless hit.
Oh,
me.
Awesome.
Yeah, that was
amazing. So it's hard to know what to say after hearing such incredible poetry and song. Before we go tonight, I wanted to let you know who would be appearing next week. And Dr. Dorothy Fields mentioned Mr. Timothy Barber numerous times tonight. He is the person that is leading the Black Archive forward, and he will be our visiting scholar next week to talk about what happened in Overtown. We've got so much more great poetry and music in the can, and by that I mean, you know, after two recording sessions at the Betsy, we have so much to share with you. So we hope you'll join us, and we also hope that you'll share with friends why it's important to join us and hear the message, and of course, enjoy the music and poetry. And I'm going to hand it to Carole Ann to introduce our last performance.
Mm-hmm. And before you go, we want you to sit back and enjoy this powerful, powerful, as you've already seen, Butterfly doing Harlem in Overtown, which will recap the story we just shared with you tonight. And we look forward to seeing you next Monday night, same time, same station. Hopefully by next week, we will make it a little easier for you to be able to get on the Zoom. We're working on that. Mm-hmm. Thank
let me
you.
Let me share one more thing while John is teeing this up. Every evening of these four sessions, we're gonna close our session with an image from a new book that came out in 2019 called Sounds of Freedom by Lenore Anthony, a Miami. She calls herself an archivist. She's an archivist and artist. And she has been working with a photographer in Italy who took images of legacy jazz musicians when they were in Europe. And these are the same musicians that appeared in Overtown. So tonight we'll be sharing one of those images with a quote by Muhammad Ali, who I think most of you know, like I do, was also a poet in addition to being a boxer. So we hope you enjoy that closing image that you'll see right after Butterfly's performance.
Okay, here
Take
we go.
Take it away, John.
All right.
Oh yeah, Harlem in Overtown. Inspiration comes from many directions. I just want to tell you, thank you, Langston Hughes, for not listening to your daddy when it came to your visions, your desires, your goals, and your direction of where you wanted to place the fitting of you in this thing called life. See, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be standing here right now delivering these poetic lines. Because it's because of you that I fell into that ambiance and love for poetry. Wordsmith is something about weaving the 26 letters of the alphabet together to tell a story or just to give a vibe. And it was because of you that we as African Americans, Black folks, colored folks, learned the beauty of jazz. And it makes sense. I said it makes sense that we were recognized as the Harlem of the South, because at the end of the day, Miami in its own roots has always been referred to as a baby New York. I'm gonna take you back a little bit, let you know what used to be in Overtown when it came to the hotels and the nightclubs and transportation, that is. Clyde Killings got you to your destination point for just 15 cents. Oh, and every area has a corridor, and Overtown's corridor was 2nd Avenue. Whether it was from 1st Street all the way to 13th Street in between, life was happening. I said life was happening. See, unfortunately, here on Miami Beach are African-American brothers and sisters that were entertaining and getting folks into the groove weren't able to
rest their head over here. They can entertain you, but they couldn't sleep and go dream chasing. So they had to transfer their bodies back over to the other side of Overtown. First black-owned hotel was Dorothy Hotel, owned by D.A. Dorothy, educator. Then you had Baby Comb Hotel. Oh, yes. Oh, and what you know about going to check out a movie? For only 6 cents, that was the Ritz Theater, that is. And 10 cents gets you a tub of popcorn. You know, you gotta have a treat while you're watching that movie on the screen. Oh, yeah. Lena Horne, Ella Fitzgerald, Duke Ellington, Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, they all found themselves within the midst of the corridors of Second Avenue and Overtown. The Carver Hotel was always packed. Oh, and Cab Calloway, he was one of the favorites at the Rockland Palace. Oh, yeah. You know about that favorite. That no matter how many times they come in town, you always want to make sure you got a seat. Front row if possible. Yeah. I'm talking jazz. Good old jazz. I'm talking history. Overtown history. We are the ones delivering the essence and beauty of that overture. On these 88 keys. You have the one and only Ellen Poe. And over here, to my left, you have the one and only Jamie giving you that bass sound. Nothing like those riffs. Nothing like those changes. Nothing like those breakdowns. Oh, yeah. See, life ain't nothing but a groove. You just gotta know how to get into it, fall into it, and love it.